So what I'd like to do, if I can, is go on and talk then about this theme, the view from the afflicted. Now, as I said very quickly, that's Gregor Wolbring's term. And we're going to, I hope, understand that a little bit. But I have a prelude to begin with, and that is perspectival, obviously, because my focus is Nietzsche. Epicurus, we see the conventional representation of Epicurus here. That's not exact, obviously. And Ivan Illich. So that's the focus. After these three prefatory, there will be three of them, reflections on pain via Nietzsche, pleasure via Epicurus, and health, obviously via Ivan Illich, I'm going to be reading Gregor Wolbring on the question of ableism and disability studies, in addition to, and that's more complicated, and I won't be able to cover this because it's a little bit more demanding, on life and the great health, what Nietzsche named the great health. Pain. Nietzsche named pain, following the metaphor of a dog, pain, as he suggests, can dog one. This is his focus, my dog, as an elusive shadow or companion. Similarly, pain can resemble a dog in its tendency to lead and to pull and to disappear, vanish. Thus Nietzsche writes in The Gay Science, here's that quote, "I've given a name to my pain and call him dog. He's just as faithful, just as importunate and shameless, just as entertaining, quite as smart as any other dog. And I can rule over him and vent my bad moods on him, as others do with their dogs, servants, and wives." This is hard. It's hard to interpret. What can Nietzsche mean by this? Is this his own personal relation to pain? Is it a private confession? Perhaps it is, but biologically, psychologically, phenomenologically, pain seems to work as Nietzsche describes it. It's hard to assess. It's there. It's not there. One can imagine it has gone, but still, there it is. Moreover, the mind, this is maybe the transition point, doesn't lend itself to constant absorption with pain. Point Epicurus underlines thousands of years ago, even when the circumstances suggest that it's objectively the case. And we thought, right there, objectively, it's strange. What would this objectivity be? Can it be proven? This protean quality has enormous implications for what we think about pain, but also about life and death, about life-altering illness. And we're getting a lot of exercise with that thought in the current COVID crisis, and disability, which is the theme. Now, I thank in the footnotes, if you see the text and it's about to be published, so you can indeed see that I cite with gratitude Abraham Olivier, because he has some very interesting reflections on Nietzsche and pain. So there's, for those of you who want to raise that question. But Nietzsche goes back to his own first book on tragedy in his 1886, which is a later written attempt at a self-criticism, a preface to that first book. He reflects that one fundamental question is that of the relationship of the Greeks to pain, the degree of sensibility. Only to wonder if this relation for the Greeks had, and that's his question, always remained the same, or did it invert itself, just in order to pose, to raise the question, if really there were always strong longing for beauty, for festivals, delights, new cults, pleasures, grew out of lack, deprivation, out of melancholy, out of pain. The point, as I argue in the Hallelujah Effect, that came out in 2016, the soft cover, Rutledge, it was originally an Ashgate book hardcover. The Holy Effect is already strangely in the original text of The Birth of Tragedy, when Nietzsche points to the pleasure in pain, that is the enjoyment. There is no other word for it, you have to call it enjoyment, of dissonance, the pleasure, right? In music, playing, in every sense with the spur of displeasure. The German is Stachel, des Unlusts. here, and obviously the reference is explicitly a matter of Beethoven's musical dissonance beginning from the start, which is when Nietzsche first mentions him, Birth Tragedy number one, his first section. With Nietzsche's effort to explain the Dionysian roots of the musical tragic art form, just as, and then he goes on in the second section, he says, compares, say, works in the same way as healing drafts, Heilmittel, medical treatments, healing means, resemble poisons. To this extent, Nietzsche's fond of David Hume's reminder of Vanitas. As Nietzsche cites this particular phrase, he cites it in English in his untimely essay on the use and disadvantages, in this case, Nutzen und Nachteil, the disadvantages, in really very strong term, of history for life. And from the dregs of life, hope to receive what the first sprightly running could not give. It's very sardonic on Hume's part. And to the same extent, Hume cites the Italian poet Giacomo Leopardi, more pessimistic, if that can be imagined, than Schopenhauer, to remind us that pain and boredom are our being. Schmerz und Langeweile ist unser Sein, uttered as a kind of comfort. Calm yourself, beruhige dich. For Nietzsche, it is one's creative condition, one's strength, one's culture that allows or does not allow pain to give birth in and through pain. This is limited to the tragic ages, he writes, as human beings are mostly played out on one side, even in the case of the highest talents. Now, the means developed against pain involve a kind of numbing or stunning of the sensibilities under which technical means, Nietzsche counts religion and art, along with the usual narcotics. Here, Nietzsche contrasts the ambition to conquer pain with a different concern for happiness. To this must be balanced one's physiological and cultural capacity for pain. The Greeks, Nietzsche will argue, have a greater capacity for suffering. By contrast, a child tends to live in the moment, the shorter rhythm of its physiology, less consternated by the past. A child can fall down, a very small child, and then in a few moments be laughing again. So the past doesn't really weigh, and the future concerns that preoccupy adults aren't a problem. What's crucial is that in the case of pleasure, Nietzsche writes, Gay Science 316, one is almost automatically a child again in the moment, not asking the question of causation or origin. Pain, by contrast, always raises the question about its origins. Similarly, pains are signs indicative both of what is and of what it is, and what is about to come. This is the only citation here that is the Nietzschean reference. Everything else is gloss. Similarly, we're going to move now to Epicurus and hopefully read between that. The theme will be pleasure. Pain, pleasure. Every life, says Epicurus, theorist of pleasure and enjoyment, even life at its extreme, in pain, in grave illness, contains an excess of pleasure. Now, just so that, because you saw the question of the glossing here, you can see that I'm not quoting Epicurus out of context. Let's quote from the Principal Doctrines, and that appears in a little book for class that I put together here. Continuous pain, Epicurus writes, doesn't last long in the body. On the contrary, pain, if extreme, is present a short time. And even that degree of pain, which barely outweighs pleasure in the body, doesn't last for many days together. Illnesses of long duration even permit of an excess of pleasure over pain in the body. Very interesting reflection. Now, the pain in question, like the pleasure in question, this is my gloss, is a kind of limit term, very important. As Nietzsche writes, to express this Epicurean point, here speaking of pain as representation, this is Nietzsche. There is only one life, one sense, one pain, one pleasure. For Nietzsche, and he arguably never departs from this inside, pain, contradiction, is voracious being. The German is das wahrhafte Sein. That's the true. Pleasure, harmony, is the appearance. Reverse this inside, and one will need a theodicy. The Epicurean point goes beyond the limits of this essay, but it's gonna do to note that Epicurus draws on models of Stoic physics, whereby pleasure, that's the argument, reaches a maximum fairly quickly, so that, Epicurus argues, the only thing to be added is difference and repetition, and where pain in any degree subtracts from pleasure, many pains are supportable if it is supposed, I think of going to the dentist, that kind of is a standard example, on balance, the account is an economic one, and of course we're actually living this with COVID, it's very terrible, more pleasure than pain. Benefit. Pleasure in the body admits no increase. This is Epicurus' principal doctrines again. When once the pain of want has been removed, after that it only admits a variation. You get to mix it up. The limit of pleasure in the mind, however, is reached when we reflect on the things themselves and their coarseners, which cause the mind the greatest alarms. As quoted in Diogenes Laertius' Lives, Book 10, Epicurus regards pleasure as our first and kindred good, and pain is an indication or achievement of what one might further seek, he says. For the end of all our actions is to be free from pain and fear. And when, once we have attained all this, the tempest of the soul is laid, seeing that the living creature has no need to go in search of something that's lacking, nor to look for anything else by which the good of the soul and of the body will be fulfilled. When we're pained, because of the absence of pleasure then, and only then only, do we feel the need of pleasure. Wherefore, we call pleasure the alpha and omega of a blessed life. Pain remains central to this definition, clearly. By pleasure, we mean the absence of pain in the body and of trouble in the soul. For Nietzsche, contrasting the cynic and the Epicurean, it's the Epicurean who transcends pain by regarding it obliquely, sort of like indirectly, rather than from within the perturbation in his own soul. You kind of take a perspective outside of yourself, seen through a glass, like, that's the quote from The Human, All Too Human, the violent rustling of the treetops outside in the storm. Now, qua, in terms of what must be distinguished as Nietzsche's perspectivalism, I always make this distinction because it's not perspectivism, it's a perspective on perspective. Such ataraxia lends the Epicurean a decided advantage, we quote. Reinstitution of peace and stillness, und Stille in the realm of the intellect, displacement of modern noise, that's in the Nachlass, echoing Nietzsche's own Sanctus Januarius resolve in the first edition of the Gay Science, not to decry, but only to look away. Now, the next section is health. A third preliminary reference here is the same Ivan Illich, already mentioned, 1926, and he died in 2002, in connection with Nietzsche on pain. I started with this here in specific terms with respect to Illich's definition of health. For Illich, deeply familiar with the cybernetic self-assertion of technology in modern scientific medicine, already then, it's not a new thing, but not less with the cultural history of human flourishing, health is a process of adaptation. That's Illich's definition for medical nemesis. It's not the result of instinct, but of autonomous and live reaction to an experienced reality. It designates the ability to adapt to changing environments, to growing up and to aging, to healing when damaged, to suffering, and to the peaceful expectation of death. Health embraces the future as well, and therefore includes anguish and the inner resources to live with it. Now, Illich first wrote this in 1974 in an article published in The Lancet and communicated widely to physicians. Although critical, Illich's report is by no means that of an extern. The medical community, this is a medical journal, was then and to this day deeply interested in the substance and reality, alas ongoing, of iatrogenic, that means doctor-caused disease, and Illich's critique. For Illich, health, after all, it's another quote, is simply an everyday word that's used to designate the intensity with which individuals cope with their internal states and their environmental conditions. The trouble, as Illich argues, lies in what he calls expropriation. That is alienation, taking over from someone what is theirs, handing over this, what is one's own perception and understanding of bodily flourishing to a third party for validation. That means getting a test and treatment. That means seeking healing. The handing over, being as literal as it is figurative, and Illich will observe that the same conundrum holds for pain in the face of the modern medicalization that is our everyday given or technological cultural inheritance. This isn't a quote, except for the handing over. This particular language is alienation, handing over this, basically that, from Medical Nemesis 7. Now, Illich continues the quote. Here is a quote: to the degree, medical nemesis, to which the individual becomes dependent on the managing of his intimacy, he renounces, that means your inner state, his autonomy and his health must decline. The true miracle of modern medicine is diabolical. It consists of making not only individuals, but whole populations survive on inhumanly low levels of health, personal health. That passage should be thought about again and again and again, both of these. That health should decline with increasing health service delivery is unforeseen only by the health manager, precisely because his strategies are the result of his blindness to the inalienability of health. The adaptive aspects of health and life, as Illich details, correspond, just as Nietzsche also emphasizes, to those changing aspects of life and becoming that philosophy, beginning, of course, with Parmenides, prefer to deny. Plato and Aristotle will be part of this, as Nietzsche writes. Death, change, old age, as well as procreation and growth, are to their minds objections, even refutations. Together with Heidegger's reflections on authenticity or ownness, or better said, ownedness, Eigentlichkeit, usually just translated authenticity, what's expropriated, what's taken over from what is properly one's own. And this is what Illich really takes a lot of time to explicate, is Eichnet, meaning taken over from one. And it's not merely one's own health or one's own life, as the patient lives from then on in his or her life, and this is what we're doing, on the terms of medical care providers, but one's own death as well. It's not just your life so that you have life, but it's also the way then that you die. Very important and complicated is aspect. Indeed, what's taken over from the individual is the individual's dying of his own death. The patient's unwillingness to die on his own makes him pathetically dependent. He has now lost his faith in his ability to die, the terminal shape that health can take, and has made the right to be professionally killed into a major issue. That's chapter 2 in Medical Nemesis. Identifying the ability to die as the terminal shape that health can take, Illich addresses palliative care and our concern for what we regard as a good death, a death free from pain and discomfort. Now, elsewhere, I've argued that so far from relieving one of one's cares, including the pains and challenges of everyday life, a Heideggerian ethics, that's Ampolitik Prisée, is actually a book on Heideggerian ethics of assistance, solicitude, support, is being argued for in its most positively solicitous expression, where just this wouldn't free one from or of those same cares, but much rather for them. Now, for Illich, we tend to outsource our definitions of illness, health, and illness and pain, all three, because they're all related, requiring a physician's involvement. Now we need a certificate. We need proof, a passport saying that it's so. And that means an involvement with medicine at every stage. To be sure, as Illich notes, the medical profession isn't always, we can say today, or not quite the panacea that can be supposed. And doctors are often curiously withholding. Opiates, he writes, aren't available on demand. Patients who have severe pains over months or years, which narcotics could make tolerable, are as likely to be refused medication in the hospital as at home, lest they form a habit in their incurable, but not directly fatal, condition. Now, Illich makes the case, I have this thing here, that pain, he says, is rendered tolerable not only by painkillers, for him, he'd be all for those, we've already noticed that, but also by one's culture, by interpreting its necessity if there's a context. Illich argues that this hermeneutic effect in assessment or recognition of necessity makes all the difference. Indeed, he says, only pain perceived as curable, pain you don't have to have, is intolerable. The problem for Illich is that in our medicalized culture, it's solely medical authority and not the patient, him or herself, that authoritatively determines, and that means legitimates, which pains are authentic and which are imagined and which are simulated. So the strange thing is that someone else will tell you whether you're imagining your pain, and someone else will tell you whether you're simulating your pain, and someone else will tell you whether it's genuine. There's a problem right there, okay, for Illich. The concern with professional confirmation is the expropriation of the patient's own pain as such, taken by the medical industry, including, to be sure, the dying of the patient's own death, as if one cannot die without such intervention. Now, Peter Skarbenek, you see his The Death of Humane Medicine and the Rise of Coercive Healthism, he echoes some of Illich's points in his comments on what he calls healthism. We probably need another term these days. I need the reference to Skarbenek, both to link my previous comments on Illich, but also as I'm going to go on to reflect on the parallel notion of ablism in the pathbreaking essay by the biochemist Gregor Wolbring, Confined to Your Legs, featured in the essay collection edited by Al Lightman, Daniel Sarovitz. Alan doesn't like it if you say his name. So anyway, and Christine Desser, Essays on Technology and the Quest for Human Mastery. It takes me to the next section. So my three prelates, now I have section one. I have several sections, and the first one is Gregor Wolbring's view from the afflicted and, that's his term, final solutions. Wolbring begins his essay conventionally, citing, as he does, a Nobel laureate, James Watson, on the promise of science, specifically DNA or gene science, to, and for the sake of bioengineering life, such that birth defects, is the promise, could become a thing of the past. An economically, techno-scientifically astute author, Wolbring himself doesn't need, he already be working in the field, was already au courant, and doesn't have to wait until more recent years, would have been a dozen years ahead of what he was writing at that time, to what we think are new CRISPR editing techniques, then already anticipated by the Genome Project and the promise of designer babies, just the features you're looking forward to in your new child, and no part of the unanticipated challenges you're not expecting. Wolbring cites technologies already available, already in practice and for some time, used for the sake of dealing with these untoward pregnancies, which is namely termination. In fact, the negative option for designer babies is the technique of choice. You don't quite so much get to engineer the child as much as get rid of the ones that aren't quite ideal, quite because more achievable for than any other technique for having a dream child. Thus, Wolbring points out that the prize-winning scientist, this means Watson himself, invokes existing technologies such as ultrasound and amniocentesis. This is the cutting edge new science, when those things have been around for some time, along with emerging prenatal and pre-implantation tests, those are the new ones, offer abortion and embryo selection as the definitive preemptive solution to disability. So the way to cure disability is not to fix it, but to get rid of the children who are disabled. Thus, there need be no disability, and yet in some cultures, including Western culture, given certain family considerations, mere sex, merely being female, say, could be a decisive reason to opt for medical termination. This was a problem when Wolbring wrote his essay, and the problem is ongoing. It's important to understand here that moral outrage per se, whatever his personal sentiments on the matter may or may not be, is less Wolbring's concern than foregrounding some of the complications of the genie that is a tech solution proposed for everything, quite independent of existing tech as such. So Wolbring continues, in the same essay, Dr. Watson, for example, seems to offer up abortion as a solution to everything from cystic fibrosis to dyslexia. If that makes you squeamish, you can turn for relief to the coming hybridization of biotechnology, genetic technology, and nanotechnology. See, he's already so much ahead of what we are currently right now, because it's become a current recognition of technologies available, which promises someday, that it'd be today maybe, but we're still not there, to fix disabilities, impairments, diseases, and defects, and so free us from both the confinement of our genes, it may free us from the confinement to our life, and the confinement of our biological bodies. Here, Wolbring offers a standard definition, helpfully. He says, disability refers to an intrinsic defect, an impairment, disease, or chronic illness leading to subnormal functioning and expectation. The result is suffering, an inevitable, unavoidable consequence of inhabiting an undesirable, subnormal state of existence. As Wolbring goes on to recount the shock notion of worst-case scenarios that often attend commercial advertisements for athletic gear, there's a certain sensitivity to the broad impact that's occasioned by disability, just as it's the rare student who takes him or herself solo through the challenges of acquiring a higher education, the greater the need for more parental subvention, the higher the quality of the educational certificate attained, Ivy League credentials offering access to yet other more advanced golden parachutes, or what we also can speak of as a backpack, right? A backpack of privilege. So no disability affects the disabled person alone, and ableist privilege is also obviously the least visible of all of those backpacks. Himself, one of those affected, Wolbring cites Stevens and Brunner, the history of thalidomide, as they rhetorically wonder, how did parents endure the shock of the birth of a thalidomide baby? The few who made it through without enormous collateral damage to their lives had to summon up the same enormous reserves of courage and devotion that are necessary to all parents of children with special needs and disabilities. Then perhaps they needed still more courage because of the special peculiar horror that the sight of their children produced in even the most compassionate. Offering not merely a view of zero-sum thinking, such as one might draw from Epicurus' account of the quality of life in the terms of the terminally ill, an assessment that studies of palliative care hardly contradict, but rather what he calls, not the view from above as Epicurus or Marcus Aurelius might observe, or the Christian evangelist pious sentiment of angels lifting one over life's obstacles, but by way of a perspectivalist hermeneutic phenomenology, not that he names this as such, Wolbring articulates what he calls the view of the afflicted. This account deserves careful attention, especially when read from an ableist, as most perspectives can be ableist, as Wolbring details this, even among disability studies. Thus, Wolbring points out what is the point of departure, sine qua non, this is the text. Most disabled people, whether they have spina bifida, achondroplasia, Down syndrome, or other mobility and sensory impairments, perceive themselves as healthy, not sick. They describe their conditions as givens of their lives, the equipment with which they meet the world. They do not perceive themselves as subnormal. The same is true for people with chronic conditions such as cystic fibrosis, diabetes, hemophilia, and muscular dystrophy. These conditions entail intermittent flare-ups requiring medical care and adjustments in daily living, but they do not render a person as unhealthy as most of the public and members of the health professions. Imagine, very interesting observation. Wolbring continues to offer both a first person as well as a theoretical reflection on this point. One needed for addressing ableist fantasies of life as disabled, especially for those born disabled, this being the reference in question for both the eugenicist James Watson, nipped them in the bud, and for Wolbring. Wolbring's view is rare enough, and it needs to be heard, especially as the focus on the afflicted is inherently telic, intentional, how one ought to move in the world, and towards one integrated ambition, as opposed to what Wolbring importantly underlines. It is essential to grasp this point, and what for him would be utterly natural in accord with his own way of moving, specifically, as he says, I've highlighted this, it's important, crawling in the absence of legs, which, by the way, I do quite comfortably. It takes, I think, quite a bit to learn to consider this. To this extent, scientific and technological solutions are for Wolbring, and quite specifically, quite because the mainstream, a solution, part of the problem. Thus, in the era of transhumanism and transgender politics, this must be contrasted with other visions of imperfection and incompletion together with current mainstream representations of the finished and the best. So Wolbring, when one wants to think about this, hardly brings his own perspective to bear as the justification for his assessment. Instead, he draws on researched social and medical science, whereby what emerges is that the negative valuation, degradation of disability, in other words, existed primarily in the minds of the non-disabled. The claim, let's pay attention to this, is modest enough. In other words, he goes on to say, what the non-disabled think about the disabled is not what the disabled and their families think about themselves. Yet when research agendas and public policies about disability and emerging technologies are on the table, the real experts, disabled people and their families, are rarely given a voice and are often blatantly ignored. This is like, it's actually very like research on women's health, although here in his text, Wolbring is a bit more sanguine than he should be, as exactly the same parallel, knowing better, yet failing to bring this knowledge into policy, let alone practice, let alone the theoretical mainstream, also applies in this case. So that means things haven't changed for women. Alas, alas, men remain the standard research reference to this day. This has not changed. We know better. It still hasn't changed. And Wolbring's parallel claim similarly remains problematic. It endures. Today, mostly the non-disabled talk about disability. Wolbring calls for disability-oriented approaches to bioethics and other studies of disability. In consequence, and there is a good deal to be thought here regarding end-of-life debates and the like. We kind of really should be thinking about this also with terms of COVID and people in care homes. The a priori assumption of the non-afflicted is that life with a disability isn't worth living, and so the role of science and technology is to eliminate disability either by preventing it in the first place or by overcoming it, so that the disabled are indistinguishable from everyone else. Arguing that science and technology are part of the problem, as I'll note again in just a little bit, Wolbring advances a broad call for a comprehensive and responsive hermeneutic solution. He doesn't, to be sure, label it as such, but he does, in a gesture towards gallows humor, contrast this with a final solution, which is logically already standard practice. My wheelchair, he says, allows me access to all the same places that the non-afflicted can go, as long as there are ramps. Disability, in other words, is contextual. From this perspective emerges a social model of disability, which sees disability as a socially defined problem that can be addressed in ways that allow full integration of individuals into society. The management of the problem requires social action, which to be sure can be enhanced by appropriate science and technology, and is the collective responsibility of society at large to make the environmental modifications necessary for the full participation of people with disabilities in all areas of social life, just as a male-dominated society increasingly makes way for women and a Caucasian-dominated society increasingly makes way for other ethnicities. And so the problem is going for that final solution means you don't have to get to this, and that, of course, is the argument he wants to make. Wolbring, I've already noted, assumes, because it's not entirely true, that more is being done in our society to reduce male dominance, right? In medicine, that's not true. And of course, in other areas also not. And white privilege, which is, of course, as the Black Lives Matter protests over the summer also made clear, still not done. But his overall point concerning disability remains. This can be discomforting. And Wolbring invokes associations of those with Down syndrome to make the point even stronger, refusing the terminology of patient as such. Thus, the Canadian, this is a quote, Down Syndrome Society writes that the primary goal, Wolbring is now quoting, of any genetic research shouldn't be to reduce the number of Down syndrome births, so they argue, but rather to provide improved healthcare and assistance to persons with Down syndrome so that they may lead full and productive lives. Persons with Down syndrome enrich our communities, and they have much to teach us about understanding, acceptance, and appreciation for all life has to offer. This call for understanding and recognition is what Wolbring requests in his own case, reflecting that and switching to his native German to do so, ich bin ein Thalidomider. Thalidomider, ich denke eher Thalidomider. When I was a child, my parents and I were presented by our doctors with only one option, to outfit me with artificial limbs. The solution was imposed on almost all thalidomiders, despite the fact that the artificial limbs were rather crude, not very functional, and mostly cosmetic at that time. They were being prescribed in great numbers. Wolbring's point requires attention. To do this hermeneutically, phenomenologically, I have recourse to a minor, this is really nothing, of course, we all know this, relatively speaking, parallel with my own extreme short-sightedness, which I have all my life regarded as less than a good thing. To be short-sighted, right, as I am, means that I have very precise vision, very close, right, short distance. Otherwise, I'm legally blind, as I have been cheerfully informed by doctors, but my vision is correctable with a combination of both glasses and contact lenses. But correcting my vision means, this is the problem of distance and focus, that the size of the world, the whole world, shrinks into focus. The gain in resolution has a cost in both a certain precision of close perception, because with the glasses on, I really can't read small print. I lose that, and I also lose distance in size, proportionate size. At the same time, as a lifelong wearer of corrective lenses, I can't tell that the world has shrunk, because everything has. This is quite, if trivially, the point of Reichenbach's coordinative presumption of the absence of universal forces that might cause everything in the universe, say overnight, this is a cosmological conundrum, it's an example for him, to expand or to shrink. Still, if I'm of a mind to read very small print or see tiny physical objects, all I need to do is remove my corrective lenses, because without them, powers of visions are restored in fine measure, just by sacrificing the lens-conferred ability to see ordinary-sized and distant objects. Certain sacrifice. So, pointing to the dignity inherent in having the freedom to choose, this is Wolbring, how I wanted to move around, a bodily freedom or liberty perforce denied in our ableist culture, Wolbring nevertheless recalls that most thalidomiders threw away their artificial legs and arms as soon as they were old enough to assert themselves against their parents and their doctors. Once I was old enough to say no, I for myself used my legs only when the system forced me to. For example, when my wheelchair was prohibited in the university laboratories where I performed parts of my graduate research in biochemistry. Wolbring closes his essay with a quote from the urbane analytic philosopher Philip Kitscher, who points out that, I quote Kitscher, because Wolbring quotes Nietzsche, contemporary affluent societies are marked by conditions that are likely to channel prenatal genetic testing towards a very narrow idea of ourselves. Paul Feyerabend is a friend of mine, a philosopher who was also disabled. He was disabled by an injury. He was shot during the war. And as this injury was exacerbated when you're fixed by medics and so on, owing to medical incompetence. So he recounts these challenges in his memoir, Killing Time. And he also told me about these things in conversation. But I want to talk about one thing. When Feyerabend, fighting on the Austrian side, was shot as a soldier during World War II, an injury to his spine made worse, as I just said, by repeated medical interventions. Importantly, we remember medical interventions of the kind don't always help. And this is really what he writes about in Killing Time. The result was lifelong impotence as well as a limp. One believes Feyerabend, however, when he tells us that his first thought when he was shot wasn't the injury, aware as he was of it as he fell, but the thought that, at least a very interesting perspective from the level of a wheelchair, he could anticipate finally discovering at leisure the lower shelves, all of those shelves, by contrast with his previous browsing habits in the middle and, of course, upper portions of the library shelves. In this case, Feyerabend's injury concentrated his mind, but reading his book makes it clear that he was never without a sense of regret. If it helped that Feyerabend had a good and very Austrian sense of humor, it's also important to note with respect to Wolbring that much depended on the kind of human being he was born to be. The next section, too, Nietzsche on life and the great health. Now, after reading about Wolbring's attention to the perspective of the disabled or differently abled, after noting Feyerabend's complications in the complicated wake of surgery and war, we can return to Nietzsche's reflections on pain once again. Now, Nietzsche is arguably the poster child for thoughtlessness, just to quote the best-known Nietzsche quote, serving a generation ago to label the worldview of Conan the Barbarian. Now, this isn't Robert E. Howard's creation of gigantic melancholies and gigantic mirth, but depicted by Arnold Schwarzenegger in the 1982 film directed by John Milius, What Doesn't Kill Me Makes Me Stronger. With a little effort, one can update the notion to match the cult enthusiasm for HBO's serial hit phenomenon All Towards Are Pathetically Weak, as it turned out, not less misogynist, as it turned out, and imperialist, as it turned out, conclusion, G.R.R. Martin's Game of Thrones, with its watchword, all men must die. Fake language, what with the want of Latin and all, vala morgulis. Whatever. I note that the phrase, Nietzsche's phrase, right, What Doesn't Kill Me Makes Me Stronger, is part of an aphorism, incomplete then without its title. Flum, that's what we need, the military school of life. Already, there's our problem. Focusing on the school of war, military school, Kriegsschule, even more so as the work of life as such. Now, that would be death, thanatos, as Heraclitus noted when he wrote, speaking of the word for life, bios, he wrote, the name of the bow is life, its work is death. And this very, very interesting thing, as we can look at this is so un toxo unama bios ergon de thanatos. Very nice, very, very challenging. The work of life includes reciprocity with death. And this echoes in Nietzsche's title aphorism, out of the war school, Kriegsschule of life, aus dem Kriegsschule des Lebens. This in turn presupposes a phantasm. Nietzsche doesn't seem to presuppose life, he asks early in the Gay Science. Isn't that something that wants to die? Here it may help to quote Nietzsche's questioning reflections, noting again the title of the aphorism and the interrogation, questioning sustained throughout the aphorism. Life, that is, continually shedding something that wants to die. Life, that is, being cruel and inexorable against everything about us that's growing old and weak, and not only about us. Life, that is, then being without reverence for those who are dying, who are wretched, who are ancient, constantly being a murderer, And yet, old Moses said, thou shalt not kill. Indeed, as Nietzsche goes on to write in one of his most important reflections at the outset of the penultimate book of the first four books of the Gay Science, published in the first edition, let us beware of saying that death is the opposite of life, that living is only a species, a kind of the dead, an art, right, as we see, and a very rare species, a very rare type or kind. If the German is das Lebende, ist nur eine Art des Toten und eine sehr seltene Art. If life is, qua exception, only a type, as we saw, of what's dead, health too is a kind of recuperation from sickness, a modification of the same. Nietzsche's language of the great health is as challenging as his reflection on the military school of life, or indeed what he calls great politics. That's human all too human for 71. As Nietzsche reflects in the section A Glance at the State, a concern with the political writ large overcomes every individual life, sacrificing the range of those personal passions and energies on the altar, as he uses the term there, of that same Moloch or Leviathan. As I detail this issue, I do that in this text, elusive not because of a deliberate obfuscation or style, it's not a question of the continental, but just to the point, just because to the point of complexity as such in Nietzsche's philosophy of science, Nietzsche was absorbed in the quintessentially physiological, indeed given the complexity of the environment, you have to say the eco-physiological dimension in a thinking that did not separate body and world or situation, surround, what we are slowly learning to understand via the meaning, the term milieu, once again, with Simondon's help, Deleuze's help, already named from the perspective of Nietzsche's own 19th century by way of the vivisectionist Claude Bernard, the milieu. Now, in the Gay Science, Nietzsche writes of what he calls, note the title of the aphorism, the great health, being new, nameless, hard to understand, we premature births of an as yet unproven future need for a new goal also. A new means, namely a new health, stronger, more seasoned, tougher, more audacious, and gayer than any previous health. There's a crescendo in Nietzsche's style, and many are fond of the vertical Nietzsche, the ascendant Nietzsche, but one ought not overlook the declination. Whoever has a soul that craves to have experienced the whole range of values and desiderata to date, and to have sailed around all the coasts of this ideal Mediterranean, whoever wants to know from the adventures of his own most authentic experience how a discoverer and conqueror of the ideal feels, and also an artist, a saint, a legislator, a sage, a scholar, a pious man, a soothsayer, and one who stands divinely apart in the old style, needs one thing above everything else, the great health. That one does not merely have, but also acquires continually and must acquire because one gives it up again and again and must give it up. I think this needs its own essay, but this isn't the time. Falling, Nietzsche in decadence. Walking is a controlled fall, so to speak, in the fashion of the physiologists of bodily movement. Similarly, physiologically, Nietzsche argues that health is constantly regained just because it's constantly lost. Regarding health, ability too, perhaps disability likewise, a sense of periodicity or rhythm helps us to read Nietzsche. One of the great dangers is our tendency, once again, to privilege not the ablest perspective on the model Wolbring details for us, orthogonal to a very conventional ideal of the norm, but an ideal of power to perpetuity, constant, unchanging. That's a capacity for power and for aggression that coincides with what I've called the nihilist versions of Nietzsche, a Nietzsche strangely Nazi-like, all about the will to power, utter absence of weakness, the vision of triumphing over all and everyone, as it were. And why should this be so? Why do we continue to encounter such Marvel-style comic book visions? This would be this, it's not really very Disney, if you like, a vision, and it's certainly not very DC. a sense of this. Once upon a time, a certain pop conception of the Superman, more shavy and then, once again, whatever that DC comic style Superman might have been, could have made sense a good century ago. But even then, it would have had little to do with what Nietzsche himself wrote. There's the politics that he is talking about, a grievous grand politics that costs us constantly and still, a politics we continue to install in place of the affairs of our own heart. Nietzsche himself, as is well known, was hardly the picture of Aryan glory. He's not even blonde. Well, he was actually light. His hair was light brown, but that's another story. And vision challenges made worse by ministrations that directly damaged his eyes. The talk of Nietzsche's health is a small industry fueled by a lack of precise knowledge, which some positivistically minded scholars propose to remedy by re-exhuming the corpse for tests, which medical archaeological project would go some way, one imagines, to proving Nietzsche's point regarding a type of the dead, if unlikely, just to be sober about the outcome, to assure anything else. By more positive contrast, maybe you can use some of what hair remains to subject them to DNA assays or such like, for all that can tell us. And to be sure, this is rather less than the hype that, as Laurie Andrews, and she's a very important book on designer babies, we're going to talk about in just a moment, following directly from the capitalist, or as she writes, market marvel. So, when this is Laurie Andrews' Future Perfect, when Nietzsche looks at these perfections, writing of the perfect and perpendicular body is, as he does, reminding us of what it recalls as the meaning of the earth, what can be forgotten is the emphasis the late David Allison never failed to foreground. Thus spoke Zarathustra, is a tale of downgoing, including the meaning of the earth, and hardly to be separated from the earth as we can experience it horizontally as ground, and towards which, quite as Friedrich Hölderlin writes, we bow. When we think about this, note that Nietzsche, by contrast, writes that we tend to abstract from the rhythms of life as such, seeking above all what's fixed and doesn't change. Let's quote again, this time at length. Everything that philosophers handled over the past thousands of years turned into concept mummies. Nothing escaped their grasp alive. Whenever these venerable concept idolaters revere something, they kill it and stuff it. They suck the life out of everything they worship. Death, remember we already quoted this, old age as well as procreation and growth, are in their minds objections, refutations even. Now, if, as Nietzsche also details, this is the force of his critical genealogical thinking and beyond good and evil, and its successor polemic on the genealogy of morals, sickness and age and decadence express life and power differently from health and youth and abundance. What's the key here, perhaps to be avoided, is the notion that one might achieve health and abundance once and for all, any more than youth. That is to say, that a youth that doesn't, a health and abundance that doesn't constantly expend itself, will give itself out. Nietzsche writes, above all, a living thing wants to discharge its strength. Life itself is will to power. The genuine philosopher lives imprudently. This is a philosopher who dares or risks himself, rather than one who conserves or saves himself slavishly. Keep yourself alive, that's how you prove you're a slave. The noble spirit that is, however impetuously, in love with life, that's the contrast. As Nietzsche writes in Twilight of the Idols, section 44, the genius in his works, in his deeds, is necessarily a prodigal. His greatness lies in the fact that he expends himself. Now, Nietzsche's Zarathustra tells us the secret, he says, that he's told, and the secret is the rhythmic secret of physiology. Here again, we should know the section title on self-overcoming. And life confided the secret to me. Behold, it said, I am that which must always overcome itself. There is much that life esteems more highly than life itself. Accordingly, a crucial limitation of transhumanistic readings of Nietzsche is that they're slavish readings, reactive readings, seeking not to express or to give out power and strength in the manner of the healthy, but to conserve power in the miserly manner Nietzsche describes as belonging to the slave, to the sick. Thus, when Nietzsche names himself a physician and speaks of health, it can be essential to note the rhythms and periodicities of pain, as he began with this, and as it may help us to grasp what Nietzsche also names an astonishing finesse, lovely language, to wit, and he's not here invoking any kind of quarantine, that the strong, the healthy, quite as they are, always losing or giving out strength and health, must be protected from the weak, the sick, as those who are slavishly moral, those who seek instead of strength and health. They seek to be protected. Preservation, they seek conservation. In Nietzsche's account of the slave revolt in morals, the nobles are sacrificed to the only fiction that is the legacy of the West. That means that today's noble believes it's possible to choose not to be noble, as Nietzsche says, believing, as the slaves do believe, that a bird of prey is free to be otherwise. This is Nietzsche's archaeogenealogical insight. Nietzsche doesn't write for the overhuman, not merely because there aren't any overhumans. It takes what seems to be the whole of history to achieve such overhumans, and then he says one kind of gets over them. But rather, those human beings, those overhumans, are set aside in favor of what? The only kind of human being that survives beyond the day after tomorrow, the only kind that really is built to last, and that's the incurably mediocre. Nietzsche had supposed, and this would have been his faith in science, that biologists and medical scientists, physiologists, might consider individual differences between individuals, that's to say, in terms of a multifarious variety of types, instead of one test for everybody is what we're doing right now for one virus, rather than as contemporary science focuses on genetic specification, numerical assays, statistically calculated in terms of general, once again, typology. If Nietzsche's expectation of further differentiation in medicine and physiology is yet to be realized, this hardly makes this non-desirable, but it does testify once again to complexity. I have sought to call attention to the need to include other possibilities beyond solutions, to leave us perhaps to what is our own, including troubles and cares, however much this may disturb a mainstream sensibility. As Wolbring also argues this, for Wolbring, our solution is the problem if it violates the fundamental point he seeks to argue. The medical model of disability creates the illusion of choice because it internalizes the belief that disabled people are subnormal and offers science and technology as the solution to subnormality. But if disabled people are people indeed, if they can experience life as fully as the non-afflicted, and if the main obstacles to this richness can be overcome by social action, then what appears to be choice is unmasked as coercion, as a constriction of choice. And science and technology, mediated through the medical model of disability, become the levers of the coercion. Wolbring argues that the danger here is already codified in law, and not just in the market desirabilities, as we above cited at Laurie Andrews is noting. Thus, disability, he says, is still viewed as a deviation from the desired norm, whose cure lies in science and technology, not in the enforcement of the principles of human rights. If the line between ability and disability is a shifting one, think of my rather horrible contact lens example. That's not my ideal example, but it is very literal and it is very, very phenomenological. Wolbring underlines that when it comes to disability, the context remains tipped against the disabled. What can we gain for life, quiet as Nietzsche spoke of it, if we learn to read this as we have above been attempting to read Wolbring? If you go out, and I recommend you do, take a look at his text. If we look beyond what we see as affliction and what we're supposed to be non-affliction, learning to see the rhythm as Archilochus strums out in his poems, in his writing, to teach his own soul to metum, the rhythm that holds our lives. Thank you for your attention.